Mira la izquierda. Mira la derecha. ¿Qué ves? ¿Dónde estás? In a world that seems to change daily, what will you do next? Welcome to the Next Steps Show with Peter Vasquez, a starting point for discussion y un poco de dirección.
Buenas tardes. How is everybody today? Sí, soy yo, to conservative New Yorker, aquí on the WYSL Studios. And you know what? I love spending lunchtime with you, if I haven't made that clear already. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, check this out, right? Today we're going to have a serious conversation about something very important. And my guest today is a voice that, yeah, you've heard her voice a lot. Some of you may even be like, oh my God, not again. But I'll tell you what, this is a person full of wisdom. This is a person that does what she does, not just because she's passionate, but because she knows the impact that these kinds of issues that we're going to discuss today has in our society. And she's decided to say, listen, I'm done with the games. I don't care what party you are. I'm done. We are going to sit here and she is going to fight, and she is going to ensure that those that we put in office remember that life, right, plays a role. But check this out. Today isn't even a discussion on abortion. Right now, you're going to think it is, because the left is going to be like, these Republicans, blah, 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 blah. They're trying to take away your abortion rights. But you know what? Today's discussion ain't got nothing to do with that. Today's discussion has to do with the proposition that they're going to put on the back of the ballot that the appeals court didn't take up. And the lower court said, sure, it can go on, even though procedures weren't followed. But hey, we know what state we live in. So check it out, ladies and gentlemen. It is, as always, my honor, my pleasure. Sí, señorita, it is going to be phenomenal, because I am bringing on the extraordinary machine, the mayor of Realville, and now the campaign manager, right, for an initiative to stop, right, Proposition 1 from becoming a constitutional amendment. And we're going to tell you why. Ayesha Kreutz, thank you for joining me today. Unfortunately, you're not joining me as my co-host. But you know what, though? What you got to talk about today requires a good dialogue going back and forth as an interviewee. You cool with that?
I'm cool with that.
Super de duper great.
So hola, right. Vita. Hola. Yes, thank you for having me. And yes, not as the co-host, but I'm excited to be here anyway. It's always a pleasure.
Always a pleasure. So what's new in your life before we get into this interview and I put you in the hot seat?
Just, you know, working with this campaign and, you know, kids, grandkids, horses, same old, you know, trying to, you know, let Jesus corral me into whatever he wants me to do at any given moment. So, you know, sometimes it's hard to be in submission and follow that kingdom plan. So, but that's what I'm doing. And absolutely, I love every minute of it.
And there ain't no stopping you.
Yes.
You're like a steam engine. You're like, I'm moving forward. I ain't taking no prisoners.
Well, you know, I think when we keep our eye on the prize, you know, I've read the end of the book. I know, you know, who wins, and I know whose I am. And I think that a lot of times, if we as individuals understand that, it becomes less and less about ourselves, right? It's like this bizarre oxymoron. We talk about individualism all the time, and it's absolutely true. But through that individualism, as we submit to God, we become less and less. He becomes more and more. And then all the things that are happening around us, you know, it doesn't get to you. You know, no loss is really a loss. It's always a win, because duty is mine and results are the Lord's, and we know that God rules. So, you know, I don't know. I think that we, you know, if as long as you keep life in perspective, no matter what you're doing, in the end, nobody can stop you. because it's between you and God.
You know, someone asked me recently, why don't I carry a gun? And I said, you know, I don't carry a gun, not that I'm, you know, anti-gun, and you know that I love shooting guns, and I maybe would if I had the time to follow all of New York State's rules. But I always say, listen, I this is the deal. I walk with God, period. And the thing is, in my opinion, at least the way I believe it, right, you can't kill me unless God says you're going to kill me. And if you do kill me, then it's for a reason. And guess what? What's the worst you can do to me? Send me to Cloud Nine? Really?
I know. The worst thing is getting maimed and not killed.
Well, yeah, that would be... That would
it's
be
like, a... hey, you're like, no, just make sure you finish the job. I don't want to, you know, be...
So, Ayesha, I'm going to read something because I want to get into this topic, okay? We don't, you know, we only got an hour, and this is like a 20-hour-long conversation.
Sure.
So, Article 1, Section 11 of the New York State Constitution, the anti-discrimination provision reads as follows. No person shall, because of race, color, creed, or religion, be subjected to any discrimination in his or her civil rights by any other person or by any firm, corporation, or institution, or by the state or agency or subdivision of the state, right? So
you got all those words right. There was no Puerto Ricanism in there.
Hey, man. You like that? Hey,
I do. What's
look
up?
At that. You know, at the end of the day, I do know how to talk every once in a great while.
I was messing with you, bro.
So, that seems pretty all-inclusive, right? I do know that there's been changes, and this November, Proposition 1 is going to be there. It's called the Equal Rights Amendment. Talk to me about that Equal Rights Amendment. I mean, I guess there's going to be new categories like age and sex and gender identity and gender expression and reproductive health and autonomy. But, I mean, why is that bad? I mean, hey, the Constitution says life, liberty, and justice for all.
Absolutely. And so let's just, you know, I'll start with this. You know, first off, you know, the Coalition to Protect Kids New York is a nonpartisan ballot initiative issue committee. It is literally, you know, I mean, I love coalition building in general. You know, it's part of my heart, you know, the unity. But we are literally comprised of New Yorkers from all walks of life, literally. And the one thing that we've come together on is dedicated to defeating this Prop 1, right? The so-called Equal Rights Amendment, as you mentioned. We call it the Parent Replacement Act. And the reason being isn't because we're against equal rights. This is not the, you know, 70s Equal Rights Amendment that they're trying to, you know, ERA, that they're trying to portray it as. And in the beginning, you know, again, Democrats, by the way, who had first looked at this and was like, oh, this sounds great. I did too, Equal Rights Amendment. And then looking at it, there just became some concerns. For me, the very first concern was actually there's a piece at the end of that that says pursuant to law. I was a little different the way other people took it, but the new categories, you mentioned them, that they want to add the ethnicity, national origin, age, disability, all of that. But at the end of that, they also added pursuant to law. And I looked at it, I'm like, pursuant to law, pursuant to what law, right? Like if I discriminate against somebody, what law? What does it mean? Am I going to get a ticket, a fine? Am I going to go to re-education camp? Am I going to have to pay $100, $100,000? You know what I mean? Like it was so vague. And in constitutional amendments, things are supposed to be very clear so that there's not a broad interpretation of it. And so that was concerning to me when, you know, again, when the other people, because, you know, when I saw things like sex and stuff, I'm like, well, you know, we've been on this whole road of, you know, equality. We want people with disabilities to have equal rights, you know, the sex, all of that. But then, which is what some of the other folks were looking at, when they looked at it, they're like, wait a second, right? Like, if you can't discriminate based on national origin, like, what does that mean, right? Like, so can you vote, right? Even though you're, you know, here illegally. And then when you get to the age part, that's really where I didn't even get to these other pieces. I got to the age part and I'm like, hey, if you can't discriminate based on age, don't we already discriminate based on age in our society as a whole, right? We have common sense guardrails, especially for our minors. You can't drive when you're 10. You can't, you know, smoke weed now that it's legalized, whether people agree with it or not. You know, you can't smoke weed when you're, you know, 15. All of these different things. And so that's kind of where it started unraveling, where it's like, yeah, I'm for equal rights, but not gonna throw the baby out with the bathwater. It was almost like opening up the proverbial Pandora's box, right? And looking at it, you know, again, I'm staying within this age part because, again, it really got to me a lot. My children as a parent, right? That's what the reason we call it the Parent Replacement Act is looking at it. So does that mean that, you know, again, think about statutory rape laws, right? Like, does that mean my 12-year-old can die to a 19-year-old? The 19-year-old can say you can't, you know, again, there's no anything. It's vague. It's completely vague.
So let me interrupt real quick, if I may, Ayesha, okay? And we'll really get into this as soon as we get back from break. But right now, the policymakers are saying that this amendment is all about abortion rights in New York State, even though abortion was legalized in 1970, and there's no real threat against it. Ladies and gentlemen, soy to conservative New Yorkan, tengo a Ayesha Kreutz, the campaign manager for the Coalition to Protect Kids of New York. Regresamos en unos momentos, don't go nowhere, and call 346-3000.
In the Rochester and Finger Lakes region, one name stands above all others for real estate appraisal and advice.
Ryan Murphy and Associates.
This full-service real estate appraisal company can appraise and advise on purchase and sales decisions, mortgage finance feasibility, estate, matrimonial, partnership buyouts, litigation, and more for any type of property, both residential and commercial. Ryan Murphy was founded almost 40 years ago. All of our highly trained staff members have at least 20 years of experience. All our appraisers are either New York State certified, general or residential real estate appraisers.
Ryan Murphy and Associates.
Start here. RYNNEMurphy.com.
For the last couple of years, Joe Robach has been telling you about Flower City Collision in Henrietta, saying that it was started by a veteran along with his son, Zach. Hi, my name is Greg Sadwick, and I am that veteran. I want to thank the WYSL listeners for their support over the last couple of years. During those years, not only have I experienced the gratification of providing you the best repairs and customer service, it has also allowed me the opportunity to see my son develop as a young professional. So remember, Flower City Collision for your collision repair needs, and thank you for supporting our locally owned family business.
Youth for Christ Rochester is focused on keeping kids safe and healthy this summer. We provide a Christ-like culture in our skills and drills, Friday night or Saturday morning basketball. And we're so excited to start all three versions of our new God's Girls middle school programs. Consider connecting your business or ministry to one of these vital programs for city youth through a sponsorship. Reach me at mhennessy@yfcrochester.org or support us online with a one-time or monthly gift. Go to yfcrochester.org/donate.
Now that the good weather's back, you'll want to make sure your vehicle is in tip-top shape, whether it's for the daily commute or that vacation you're planning. For quality, affordable vehicle service, rely on Rock Auto Service, 1132 Westridge Road. Rock Auto has what your car, truck, or SUV needs. Oil change, brake service, suspension, alignments, exhaust, air conditioning, and tires. Check their Google reviews as one of Rochester's best for customer satisfaction. Rock Auto Service, 1132 Westridge, just east of Mount Reed, 434-5010.
Peter Vasquez and Next Step Show on the WYSL stations.
Welcome back to the Next Step Show, ladies and gentlemen. Kunto conservative New Yorkan Peter Vasquez. Today we are talking with the new campaign manager of the Coalition to Protect Kids in New York. You know, we've been talking about this amendment. Ayesha, before break, I had asked you, I said, you know, the policymakers are saying that this particular amendment is specifically to codify and enshrine in the Constitution abortion rights. But you're saying that that's a lie, that they're actually trying to take parents' rights away.
Well, so part of the amendment as well, I mean, the word abortion doesn't appear in it. It does say that, you know, pregnancy outcomes, and reproductive health care and autonomy, right? So that is thrown in there. It's, you know, I think about pork spending, right? You know, or these bills where, you know, oh, everybody agrees on one thing, and so everybody throws everything else in it. So if this was just about abortion, why didn't they, like other states, make a amendment that was just about abortion and use the word abortion? But they didn't, right? They threw this in along with everything else. And like I said, I can't, you know, you guys know me, you know, or those who do. Listen, the life issue is paramount. I mean, I would be throwing down if it was just about abortion and have no qualms about it. But it's not. Again, I can't even get past the age part as a parent, as somebody, right? If you have minor children, if you're a mom, grandma, grandpa, aunt, uncle, and you are new mother, father, your ability to be able to parent the way that we have in the past is going to be jeopardized, right? And it's basically coming at, you know, the New York State government could have more authority than parents in making medical decisions for their children if this passes. Children under 18, right, could be mm-hmm. able to have the right to medical procedures, you know, whether it's getting your ears pierced or irreversible gender-affirming care or abortions without parental notice or consent. And yep. that's the problem, right, is that we're saying, and they could have made a little caveat to this, right, under the age part and say, except for, I don't know, in the case of parental rights or something like that. We've seen 10,000 page bills, 50,000 page bills.
Yeah, we have.
You could have, yeah. they could have done that and secured our rights to say, no, that's not what we're talking about. But they didn't.
Isn't that crazy, Ayesha? They'll have like 50 people working on this humongous bill, expecting one person to read it within a few hours before they vote on it. It's I mean, really, where's the argument to that from both sides? But hey, Ayesha, I'm going to read the proposed changes to Article 1, Section 11 of the New York State Constitution, the anti-discrimination provision. And those changes reads as follows. To Section 11 A, because they added a whole other Section B. So Section A is going to be changed to include the following. It states this: no person shall be denied the equal protection of the laws of this state or any subdivision thereof. No person shall, because of race, color, ethnicity, national origin, age, disability, creed or religion, or sex, including sexual orientation, gender identity, gender expression, pregnancy outcomes, and reproductive health care and autonomy, be subject to any discrimination, his or her, their civil rights, by any other person, by any firm, corporation, or institution, or by the state, or any agency or subdivision of the state pursuant to law. Now, that sounds great. Right?
It does?
I mean, it really doesn't, but I get it. I mean, that right there would deal with the issue of abortion and all that stuff. But see, Ayesha, let me read part B.
Wait.
Section.
Yeah. Part B is just, again, doubles down on nuts. But
yeah, let me read it before you answer, though, Ayesha,
because
this is where the biggest concern comes in and why I believe it's you guys are dubbing it the Parent Replacement Act. Part B, brand new section, states this: nothing in this section shall invalidate or prevent the adoption of any law, regulation, program, or practice that is designated to prevent or dismantle discrimination on the basis of a characteristic listed in this section, nor shall any characteristics listed in this section be interpreted to interfere with, limit, or deny civil rights of any person based upon any other characteristics identified in this section. Let me highlight the fact that one of those is age. And that language right there, right, along with pursuant to law in Section A, is why this is dubbed the Parent Replacement Act. Am I wrong, ma'am?
In large part, yes. You know, again,
I am wrong?
No, you're right. Sorry. In large part, you are correct that, you know, that Section B, you know, when it says no adoption of any law, regulation, program, or practice, and then doubling down on these things that have already been tripled down on. When, again, if you pair the age with the gender identity and expression, does that mean that schools can be banned from disclosing to parents that their children are becoming transgender? Right? Like, what does that mean?
But let's parallel that, Ayesha. I'm sorry. Let's parallel that to community schools, because isn't that exactly what community schools directives are? I mean, it is in the manuscript that I have.
Yeah. The New York State Department of Education in 2023 released, you know, the thing, creating a safe, supportive, and affirming environment for transgender and gender expansive students. And within that, it's created an adversarial relationship between parents and children already without this amendment, because it instructs school administrators to not inform parents of their child's purported, their desire to change genders. We have a case in Skinny Atlas where the school was transitioning a young lady for 2 years in school, calling her by a boy's name. All of her paperwork was in a boy's name. And when the parents find out, there's a whistleblower kind of that, you know, let them know. And then, you know, they obviously pulled their child from the school, and she's back to being a girl now. She's in a private school. But what the family did was then turn around and sue the school to say, you didn't have the right to do that. I'm the parent. But if this were to become a constitutional amendment, does that mean now that they're empowered, right? Where would the standing be then for the parent to be able to sue, because it's a constitutional amendment, right? This is what, when a lot of these cases come up, again, the biological males being able to compete in biological female school sports, right? You can sue because they say, hey, you're going against the Constitution and you're offending my constitutional rights. If this becomes codified within our Constitution, then what happens to the standing for us to be able to, you know, regress and be able to sue against the schools, right? So you're basically, you know, with this as well, talking about erasing women, erasing ERA, right? Capital ERA, erasing female sports and scholarships. You know, so again, this is it, when you break this down to how vague it is, each one of these, if you wanted something that was going to be, you know, you can't discriminate based on ethnicity, make it its own constitutional amendment, right? Each one of these should be its own piece so that we could argue about whether it's valid or not on its own. But they're throwing, you know, in my opinion, and others, a lot of us, they're throwing all of these things together, because then they can be like, look, you're not for equal rights. Oh, you're against, you know, LGBTQ. Oh, you're against people with disabilities. Oh, you don't, you know what I mean? And think about this too, with the age and when we're talking about the age part, what about senior discounts? What about senior housing? I mean, like that's age discrimination. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. So do those go away?
Well, like you said earlier, what about driving? What about drinking and smoking and all that other
guns.
Stuff? Because that would be age discrimination.
Wait. What about the guns that you don't carry for some reason and tell the whole world about? Bah.
But isn't that the pursuant to law clause that they have in Section A or in Part A of Section 11?
Exactly. What does pursuant to law mean now? And then when we double it down on that Part B, right? Can you even make a law that says, oh, you can't have sex with a 12-year-old if you are 20? Because if you can't discriminate based on age, how can you make a law that says that? And the laws that are there, are they going to be challenged? Like, what, you know what I mean? Like, what is this? What's going on?
Ayesha, when we get back, I want to talk about that exactly, because we live in a state that says that all these restrictive rules are to keep us safe, right? And they're even passing social media laws to keep kids safe. So let's talk about that when we get back right here on the Next Step Show, con tu conservative neo-Rican. Regresos en unos momentos. We'll be right back.
Peter Vasquez and Next Step Show on the WYSL stations.
El baile del perrito, el baile del perrito. See, ladies and gentlemen, like I try to tell you and remind you, it's Friday. You let that stress go. Get up and dance like a doggy. Yep, baile del perrito, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the Next Step Show. We have Ayesha Kreutz, and today we're talking Prop 1. So, you know, Ayesha, I watch these policymakers and just elected officials in general. But you know, the county clerk has this meme that she has, or a picture of herself holding a sign that says she's a Democrat because she loves her child. You've got the governor, hocus pocus, saying things like, or doing things like, seeking to pass a law to protect minors from abuse on social media. You've got Biden sitting there talking about, we've got to protect our kids. But yet, they are all behind this bill. And it doesn't make sense to me. Can you tell me why?
Well, I can't tell you why. You know, again, I think that I try to give people the benefit of the doubt. I do believe that, you know, one of the reasons that we're able to be so across the board and have so many people with us is I do believe that people, you know, want to protect their kids. But I also think maybe people don't look all the way deep enough, right? You look at your own pet project and then you put the blinders on for everything else. And in the beginning, I'll say, you know, I kind of did something similar with this, right? I mean, again, I heard Equal Rights Amendment. I'm like, okay. It was like, oh, equal rights. We're going to add sex in there finally. You know what I mean? Like all of these different things. And so there was definitely, I think, for each one of us, and we just have to be careful, right? That we look at things without blinders on and say, we just have to be reasonable. And that's not always the case, right?
Okay. So all these people are saying that this is a Republican pushback, right? Marjorie Burns, who took it to court. I think it was Bob Ord from the, you know, now by Erie County. He supported that taking to court. But Coalition to Protect Kids New York, right? And this whole movement against it, The supporters are saying it's a Republican initiative. Can you describe the makeup of this coalition?
Sure. I mean, we have, you know, again, it was started by a Democrat. Most of the board are either Democrats or independents. You know, we do have some Republicans. You know, folks know, you know, where my political affiliations. But, you know, we have even those in the LGBTQ community, right, are part of our coalition. You know, whether you're Catholic, Muslim, Jewish, literally from all walks of life, because when you look at this just without blinders on and saying, you know, why is it so vague, right? This is a very vague, and the vague and broad language that is contained in this amendment is going to open up that, like I said in the beginning, that proverbial Pandora's box. It's creating constitutional rights that will be subject to litigation, right? And efforts by activist groups to create, you know, new rights. And quite frankly, that most New Yorkers are not in line with. And we can look at some of the bills that are poised to pass if this were to pass. You know, I mean, I'd love to go through a few of those. And, you know, so, and it's not, I think that when people look at it reasonably, it does become, you know, it is a little bit of a moderate issue, right? Because as a parent, I'm not any political affiliation. I'm just a parent.
So you're telling me that the Coalition to Protect Kids NY is not just bipartisan, but by culture.
Yes.
By everything. I mean, it seems to me that people across New York State, regardless of their political ideology or sexual orientation, have said, mm-hmm. "Yo, wait a minute here. All right, let's talk about these bills."
And I think that with those, you know, again, just to the sexual orientation, right? Listen, I think you and me and probably most people agree, right? Like, I don't care what you do. for the most part, right? Like, that's your business. What we're talking about specifically, right, at the coalition, again, is the age part. So what we're concerned about is that should minor children be getting puberty blockers, right? And they, like, puberty blockers, the inception of them when they started being used, right, are what we would give sex offenders to castrate, to chemically castrate them, right? It affects your brain. And so why would we be giving those to children? You already have 25 states in the United, you know, United States that are backtracking on a lot of the gender affirming care for minors. When you look overseas in, you know, Europe and all of that, they're all, they're banning it all, right? They're way far ahead of us in, you know, in doing the experiment on all of this stuff. And now they're ahead of us saying, hey, it didn't work. And what we're talking about specifically is children. And that if this is something that you want to do, if you want to have a sex change, if you want to do whatever, you do that when you're a grown adult. And if, as a parent, it's something that you think is okay for your kid, those parents have the right to know what is happening to their children and to counsel them through it. It should not be doctors, different people that are doing this without any kind of parental knowledge or consent.
And that's where I think this conversation needs to go next, because right now there are bills sitting in the New York State Legislature that has been, again, under one-party control. I know it isn't political, one-party control, that's positioned to pass and be upheld if voters approve the ERA. And, for example, that is the Assembly Bill 6761, which allows minors to make their own medical decisions without parental knowledge or consent. Now, also to that, there's the Senate Bill 762A, and that's the sister bill or brother bill to the Assembly 276B, which provides treatments for sexually transmitted diseases to minors without parents or guardian consent.
And
but hey, it doesn't end there, though. There's one more, Ayesha. It's Assembly 4604, which requires comprehensive sexuality instructions for students. Check this out, ladies and gentlemen. Not in grade 6, not in grade 7, 8, 9, or 10, or 11, or 12, right? But as early as kindergarten. Why? So talk to us about these bills, Ayesha, and what we're doing to stop them.
Well, that the second one that you mentioned is, you know, no matter how many times I hear it, it absolutely grieves my spirit. Like, I mean, like, I die inside a little bit every time and really have to ask Holy Spirit to refresh me, because the idea that we have fallen so far in our society that not only would somebody conceive of a bill that would allow minors to have sexually transmitted, a minor that has a sexually transmitted disease, to get medication for that without a parent knowing about it. The idea that A, somebody would think about that, but B, somebody would sponsor it, and then it would be sponsored so that it could actually be legitimate legislation being considered, to me, is one of the most disgusting and pernicious things. I mean, are we talking? I mean, this is, we are talking about protecting possible sexual predators.
These policymakers are saying that that's not the protection. The protection that this provides is for a minor who's having sex, right?
Correct.
It feels scared to go tell his mom and dad, and they shouldn't have to deal with that stress. That's what I'm hearing. Oh, no, we got to, you know, parents, you know, they push kids out. If a kid admits that he's, alternative lifestyle and get kicks to the street.
No. That is not what that bill says, A.
That's what people are saying
about
that bill.
I don't care. So what? If my uncle rapes me and then takes me to the doctor to get a prescription because he gave me gonorrhea, and then my mom doesn't know about it.
But what if you had sex with that uncle willingly?
Oh, so a 14-year-old is willingly having sex with their uncle?
Well, I mean, you know what I mean. Just in general, if somebody goes and has sex and they're afraid to tell mom and dad, because they're going to get beat up, why should they have to tell mom and dad?
Listen,
and this bill. Listen, I'm just asking.
If your 14-year-old is having sex, period, with whether they are doing it willingly or not, I was one of those. I had my first abortion at 14. If you are 14 and you're having sex, I will tell you there's a lot going on in your life that you need some parental guidance, okay? There is stuff that is happening in your life that is not okay. There is abuse that is happening that is not okay, and there needs to be some counsel. And to push parents out or to say that parents don't have the right to know that their child is having sexual relations is absolutely atrocious.
Ludicrous.
And it's un-American, and it's disgusting.
Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, the point of that conversation is to show you and exemplify the trickery in the language that these policymakers are using against you and me. This is the Next Step Show with the conservative Neorican Peter Vasquez. Tenemos a Ayesha Kreutz. Regresamos en unos momentos.
In the Rochester and Finger Lakes region, one name stands above all others for real estate appraisal and advice.
Ryan Murphy and Associates.
This full-service real estate appraisal company can appraise and advise on purchase and sales decisions, mortgage finance feasibility, estate, matrimonial, partnership buyouts, litigation, and more for any type of property, both residential and commercial. Ryan Murphy was founded almost 40 years ago. All of our highly trained staff members have at least 20 years of experience. All our appraisers are either New York State certified general or residential real estate appraisers.
Ryan Murphy and Associates.
Start here. RYNNEMurphy.com.
Hi, my name is Greg Sadwick, and along with my son Zach, we are the owners of Flower City Collision. We've been advertisers on WISL, the voice of liberty, for the last couple of years. So I want to thank the listeners of WISL for their patronage, which has allowed us to grow and reinvest in the latest technologies to ensure that your vehicles are repaired to the most current standards, whether conventional or EV. If you're in a collision, reach out to Zach at Flower City Collision in Henrietta, and he'll work with your national insurance company on your local behalf to ensure that your repair gets done right.
Baseball, hot dogs, and the American flag. They're all part of the rich fabric that makes our country great. Show your American spirit by purchasing your flag from the Stars and Stripes Flag Store today. When you do, you're supporting critically needed services for local veterans at the Veterans Outreach Center. Let's show our veterans that we care by placing our nation's symbol on the porch of every house in our community. The Stars and Stripes Flag Store, 783 South Avenue, Rochester, or visit eflagstore.com.
Now that the good weather's back, you'll want to make sure your vehicle is in tip-top shape, whether it's for the daily commute or that vacation you're planning. For quality, affordable vehicle service, rely on Rock Auto Service, 1132 Westridge Road. Rock Auto has what your car, truck, or SUV needs. Oil change, brake service, suspension, alignments, exhaust, air conditioning, and tires. Check their Google reviews as one of Rochester's best for customer satisfaction. Rock Auto Service, 1132 Westridge, just east of Mount Reed, 434-5010.
Next Steps with Peter Vasquez on the WYSL stations.
Hey. Ooh. Ooh. Yep, that's right. A little bit of salt and pepper. Let's talk about you and me. Let's talk about good stuff like parenting. Ayesha, I challenged you a little bit there because it's so important for people, one, to see the trickery in the language, but also understand how important it is to knock down this Prop 1, because bills like this is exactly what makes it the Parent Replacement Act.
Right. And I want to go back to that, too, because, again, it is so vital that people understand, right? Like, we are the social contract that we have. It has always been the case that we have said, as a society, that parents have the right to be part of and control their child's care, you know, direct their care, do all of these things. And this is threatening that at a fundamental level. And again, those bills that you were just talking about, right, that a child could get medical treatment without a parental knowledge or consent, about a sexually transmitted disease and being treated for it without parental consent. There's other ones that are also that, you know, there's a bill, Senate bill, there's no assembly bill with it, but would allow minors 14, years and older to be giving, you know, medical, like vaccine recommended stuff without parental knowledge and consent. Getting rid of religious exemptions for different medical procedures. There's an assembly bill, A2125, right? So there's a whole bunch of bills that are in there that are already on par to pass if this amendment, if we vote yes on it, which is why we're asking people to vote no, right? When we're looking at like private religious, you know, private education, religious education, that type of thing, what is it going to mean for them, right? Of how...
Well, that language seems to me that it's going to shut down the church as we know it, to be honest.
Well, I think that what's going to happen is you'll have a problem with free speech, right? So we're going to start self-regulating. What's the impact, right, that it's going to have on free speech for religious organizations, charitable groups, and individuals, right? Because then you're going to say, wait a second, can I say that? We already do it a little bit. I can think of some words right now that people are like, oh, sorry, I'm not supposed to say that. But again, now we're going to add pursuant to law to it. So again, if I discriminate, quote unquote, or offend you and then you sue me, if you're, what's going to happen to me? Again, am I going to get a ticket, a fine? Am I going to go to jail? Am I going to go to a re-education camp and our churches? Because it says you have... That religion is protected as well, right? It's still in there. But which one supersedes what? Does religion supersede the gender identity stuff?
Section B tells you exactly what supersedes.
Right. And so then, let's say you are a pastor or somebody, right? And you're preaching out of, you know, Genesis, one man, one woman type of thing, you know, or again, on abortion, different things. And somebody's sitting in your congregation and you feel, and they feel discriminated against. Does that mean that they can then take you to court? Who's going to win, right? And in the end, because again, these are all could-haves because we don't know, but if they can sue you as a church and then you go to court, can that, even if they win, can that church afford a $10,000, $100,000 lawsuit? A lot of these churches are small. So is it going to put them out of being able to be a church? So then what's going to happen to free speech and religion? These religious organizations? You'll start self, regulating. The thought police will come in and you're going to be like, oh, wait, sorry, say that.
But I don't think it's an if. Again, Section B, the last sentence says, nor shall any characteristic listed in this section be interpreted to interfere with, the word interfere is key, limit or deny the civil rights of any persons based upon any other characteristic identified in this section. Ayesha, pastors like Jose Rodriguez and Lighthouse Church and Catholics in general and others, they will not be able to preach against things that they believe is right and biblical. They tried this in Houston, Texas. We shut it down, but they tried it in Houston, a lighter version.
Well, and again, you know, you could say that, you know, I want to be very fair. I'm trying to be fair and impartial. And again, what the courts might wind up doing, again, that's another question, is do we want our courts to be bombarded with these kind of lawsuits? And so that's what, again, so we're asking people to vote no, and tell the legislature to go back to the drawing board. And this, and you know, I know we're going to be running short on time here. What's important for everybody to understand is you're going to be voting on this come November 5th. You're going to have to flip over your ballot, look at it, right, and vote no. And that's going to tell the, because in order for this to go through, it has to go through the legislature twice, the assembly and the Senate. In New York State twice in consecutive sessions, and then it comes to us, the people, to vote on. So this isn't something right now that you can go back to your legislature and say, don't do this. This is on us, we the people right now of New York State. This is our fight as voters to get to the voting booth and to vote no, to send it back and have them make this with less vague, less broad language. Again, maybe, you know, I think each one of them, we should have a conversation on their own, because then you can really, you know, keep it tight, because constitutionally you aren't, it's not even constitutional, I don't believe. But again, I'm not a law scholar, so I'm not going to get into that. But constitutional amendments are supposed to not be vague for a reason. And this is one of the most vague things that I have ever read. And I think that hopefully people will understand the impact that it could have on us as New Yorkers, as parents, as seniors, as religious institutions, that we're going to say no.
Ayesha, can you give us, like, in a very short time, kind of where it is legally? I know that the appeals court didn't take it up, correct? Can you tell us why? I know you're not a lawyer, just as a disclaimer.
I'm not. I guess they don't, you know, like, I can't really say, you know, with any accuracy why they didn't take it up. You know, they can choose to or not choose to take it up. There is one last ditch effort, I guess, where it can be asked to be taken up by choice. But it was my understanding that if it's a legislative, piece, right, that they have to take it up. So I don't quite understand why they didn't. We'll have the team is going to get together and find out from the lawyers exactly why it is or how they can get away with not taking it up. But it's on the ballot now. You know, we were very hopeful that it wasn't going to be in the ballot, that we would have more time. And now it's full press. It's a hard full press now. The language is already being crafted as well of what it's going to actually say on the back of the ballot as well. So if you sign up at protectkidsny.com, so again, that's protectkidsny.com. As soon as we find out all that information and some of the legal stuff, we'll send out updates. We don't like send people stuff every day, but whenever there's an important update or something coming out, we do make sure. We're also looking for people to help us to get, we have presenters who will come to your area in person to do a short presentation. It's about 20-25 minutes, and then some Q&A. So if you would like the presentation in your area, you can also go to the website and sign up for that. Volunteers, we have, you know, various committees, of course, donations. This is a ballot issue committee, so in order for us to go out there and really tell people to vote no, we do have to follow the laws of the campaign finance laws, not like for a candidate. It's a little bit more severe than that. So any donation, $1, $5 at protectkidsny.com is absolutely fabulous to help us to get our word out, the palm cards, flyers, and as well these events that we're doing across New York State.
Ayesha, thank you. What's that website?
ProtectKidsNY.com.
Keep up the hard work, ladies and gentlemen. Pay attention to the trickery of the language being used. And hey, like I've said it, I'll say it again. Be a leader, be a leader, be a leader. And say this with me. Leadership is the beacon that guides me, for it's through selfless service that I illuminate the way for others to find their own greatness. Meet us, share with us, advertise with us, nextstepshow.com. Have a great week, and Enica Torride, your conservative New Yorican Peter Vasquez, La Voz de Libertad, siempre te amamos.